Hello, everybody. Welcome to the final session of the 2020 World Snooker Championship Final. And to be honest, I just didn't think I'd be this relaxed. But you're a snooker fan, you know there's no need for pomp or ceremony or hyperbole, because Ronnie O'Sullivan is just one frame away from lifting this trophy for a sixth time. You know, we love sport to be close. We love live sport to have us on the edge of our seat, but that's just not the reality. So if and when Ronnie's name is engraved on here tonight, make no mistake, it's history nonetheless. One frame away from a sixth world title at 44 years of age, on the cusp of history yet again. Tonight, in all probability, he'll be able to look Ray Reardon and Steve Davis square in the eyes and say, hello, old friends. Well, good evening to all of you. Good evening to Jimmy White. And it is, because let's not pretend, all over bar the ticker tape.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, he had a chance this morning. He won the first game from 10-8 down to go, from 10-7 to go 10-8. Had a chance to go 10-9, didn't take it. Ronnie clicked into gear and just played marvellous snooker today. You know, unplayable, really.
You said it in the quarterfinals, the semi-finals, and indeed the final. Even a Ronnie O'Sullivan, who can't find his cue action, will click at some stage. And as you say, this afternoon, seven frames in a row is going to devastate any world final.
Absolutely. You know, he just he sensed a bit of weakness with Karen, and he just got stronger and stronger, and his cue ball control come back, his long potting come back, his safety. You know, as I said, he's just, when he gets in that mood, gets on a roll, he's greatest front runner we've ever seen in snooker, and impossible to beat, I'm afraid.
Well, kind of time to draw breath, really, and it is true that this has been a tournament like no other before. First of all, for the obvious reason, we've been trying to come to terms with this ghastly bag of jeans that has turned our world upside down. But on the less important issue of sports and of snooker on the table, I think you agree, Jimmy, this has been maybe the most unpredictable and competitive world championship I can remember. 181 frames out of 200. Then two semi-finals that go to final frames. That's been a joy.
You know, no, there's been, you know, Kirk Mafflin beat John Higgins in an unbelievable match. John Higgins had a 147. McGill, in two of his matches, he's won 13, 12 and 10, 9. Just got beat 17, 16 in the semi-final. And that incredible match with Mark Selby and Ronnie O'Sullivan go down as a Crucible Classic.
An absolute joy. It almost seems unfair just to pick out some shots, but this is shot of the tournament. Pick your favourite.
What a shot.
Why is he screwing back? Oh, what a shot.
39.
Told you he was vulnerable playing with power shots right-handed.
Well, look at this. He's got the blue out and he's on the brown.
Well, that's an interesting shot, isn't it?
It's quite a brilliant shot, I have to say. I'm very impressed by that. That's one of the best safety shots I've seen.
Wow, what a shot. What a shot, and what a flick from the yellow.
Oh, a beauty.
One. I was going to say, if that didn't get the fake applause, then there's no point having that button.
What a fantastic pot.
What a pot.
Well, what a kiss.
Another magnificent long red from O'Sullivan. You can't take your eyes off it. Haven't got much wiggle room here. Oh, what a shot he's played there. Great shot.
Well, as always with shot of the tournament, some people are angry that their favourite isn't in there. And I'm all right with that. Blame Folsey. He's on Twitter. He picked them. Jimmy, you keep yours. Whatever you pick is the actual shot of the tournament officially for Eurosport. I'm just going to pick this one. It's a different one. And it's this shot from Selby. You know, we saw him find his touch again. We saw the old Selby come back in this tournament. It's one of the headlines. But it's just so many times he picks the right shot, Jimmy.
Well, this shot's so clever because if he can only leave that red and he's on the blue to get in the red in bulk. You know, he can only leave the red he's playing. But the actual pot is so difficult. You've got to be queuing absolutely dead straight to pot that.
That's the runner-up prize if you're watching, Jester. Again, blame Folsey and Jimmy. Here we go, shot of the tournament. What have you got?
I've got the long red from O'Sullivan at 16-15 down. This was just, you know, he just clicked into gear the game before that, straight in the middle of the pocket, bounces up, and he goes on to win the frame from there and to level the match. Just, you know, if there's something wrong with that cue action, I want some of it.
The frame that will live forever, of course, the deciding frame in the semi-final between McGill and Karen Wilson. The best frame of snooker in terms of quality, and we haven't even mentioned it, it's been such an amazing tournament, 147 at last, hallelujah, and John Higgins' first ever here.
Yeah, John Higgins made a, you know, him not to have a 147 here, you know, that was the only thing missing on his CV, and he potted a couple of great shots in that break to keep it going. Yeah. Fantastic, Maximum.
Absolutely. Well, listen, let's be honest, as we've said already, Ronnie O'Sullivan is a billion to one on to win the world title tonight. And if and when he does walk out into a very rainy Sheffield with a beautiful trophy under his arm, he will trail one man and one man only.
Stephen Hendry, one of the most successful players in the history of snooker, a divine decade of dominance in the 90s, the Iceman, the golden boy, but the true king of snooker here in Scotland.
You don't really find out how good someone is until you actually feel the match against them on the table. And when I remember the first time I played him, it was at the UK semis in December 90, and I was like, he's quite good.
He was a winning machine, really. And as I say, I was lucky he got up close with him for a couple of years practicing with him. And I couldn't believe his desire. He was always, even though he was 4 or 5-time world champion at the time.
I remember hearing a story, and I don't know if it's true, that he won the UK Championship on the Sunday night. Himself and John Carroll travelled through the night back up to Stirling, and he was back in the club at 10 o'clock the next morning to practice.
If I got the better of him in practice, he was first in the next morning. He was all geared up to give me a bashing.
He was like a machine, wasn't he, really? You know, he's just a potting machine.
You'd expect him to crumble at some stage, but his self-belief and his will to win was second to none, and definitely one of the players when I was a junior growing up who I looked up to. He was definitely one of my idols.
And he had a strut and a kind of, now I'm here, you can all sit down and I'll do what's going to be done.
You just never expected him to lose, really, you know, and just dominant for 10 years.
I think that he went 5 worlds in a row. He was unbeaten at Sheffield for, I think it was like 28 matches. I think that's just a crazy feat. No one will ever get close to that, in my opinion.
I learned so much from practicing with him for 2 years or 3 years. It was difficult. I was picking out balls for the first year, probably going home crying some days as well. But in the long run, I might not be in the top 16 if it wasn't practising with Hendry.
I think he retired at the right time for him. I wish he'd have kept playing just because I loved watching him play, but that's from a selfish kind of way of looking at it.
Now seven for Runny to win another two. I don't know, I mean, he's capable, but to get to seven, I don't think it'll ever be achieved. I think that will be one of the few records that Hendry will stay with.
Maybe, yeah, maybe Judd could have a go at it.
There's not been really that great sportsman that ever came out of your country. And then when he came on the scene when he was 17, I think every Scottish snooker player looked up to him. I know we had all our favourites with your Steve Davises and your Jimmy Whites, but as soon as Stephen came on, now he was everybody's hero from then on. So he was certainly mine when he was growing up as well.
Well, in about half an hour from now, catching Hendry might be double as likely as what it felt 2 weeks ago. But what did Hendry bring to snooker that pushed the sport forward?
He was such a great potter, you know, and had great self-belief. I remember I played him in a couple of exhibitions when he was very young, 14, 15.
Wow.
And a couple of years later, his manager phoned me, Ian Doyle, and said, Stephen's not practising as much as he should do. And the next time I see him, I said, listen, I said, if you want to win tournaments and be the best, you've got to practise. That's the worst advice I should have given him, because he beat me in four world finals.
Bad idea.
But, you know, he was just an incredible long potter, and he had such a straight cue action.
Everyone will be trying to separate the grits if and when Ronnie wins this, have to keep saying that, this sixth title. And I think it's folly to do that. But I was looking at sort of those four. Reardon won all his titles in one decade in the 70s. Davis won all his six titles in the 80s. Hendry won all of his seven titles in the 90s. That's what makes Ronnie O'Sullivan unique, whether you think he's the best or not, because this is about to be the third decade he's won it in. He's not a machine. He's never been a machine. He's lightning in a cracked bottle.
Absolutely. You know, what Ronnie O'Sullivan has is so much natural ability, but adding to the natural ability, he's got the will to win. He's worked on his game with Ray Reardon to have a great safety game. His positional play is better than anybody's in the game. And he's potting, you know, his long potting is still there at 44. Yeah. Amazing.
And a mind that just cannot be fathomed. When we return, we'll be very close to the first and quite possibly the last frame of the fourth session of the 2020 World Snooker Championship. Regardless, the old lady is looking beautiful again tonight. We're back very shortly here in Eurosport, your home of snooker. This Saturday and next Sunday on Eurosport 2. Right here, right now, a champion-elect waits in the wings, one frame away from once again becoming king of the world.
Every year I come here, I have a huge amount of doubt. I'm one of them people that doubts myself all the time.
Just have to rely on your instincts, rely on your ability and rely on your belief and just kind of go in there and make every shot count.
Ronnie O'Sullivan takes control of the final.
It looks as though this evening's final session is going to be a lap of honour for the five-times champion, Ronnie O'Sullivan. He's 17-8 ahead. He's one away from being crowned champion for a sixth time.
So all over bar the shouting, but for Karen Wilson, his first experience of a world final, and at 28, few would bet it would be his last. No matter how many times you make it, no matter how many times you win or lose it, it's something that stays with you forever, as our Jimmy knows well.
The morning of the final, you wake up full of butterflies, you've seen your family that you haven't seen for 17 days, you can't wait to get out to the Crucible and start your campaign to be world champion. Walk into the Crucible from your hotel, you're absolutely buzzing. You're either going to come out of the Crucible world champion or, unfortunately for me, runner-up. It's time to go to the dressing rooms. This is a time where you focus. Different players do different things. Some people like to be on their own, read a newspaper. Some people like to have their coaches. But the main thing is to stay focused, because you've got four sessions of intense snooker, so you've got to stay in the moment. While you're in the dressing room, you get a knock on the door from the tournament director. it's time for you to go and perform in the World Championships. You go through the corridor, you see all the previous winners on the board, and all you want to do is get your name on there. When the MC mentions your name and you walk through that famous curtain and the crowd are shouting your name and willing you to win, it's the greatest feeling in the world. You also clock the trophy. You can't help but to glance at it, hoping that you will be picking it up and raising it above your head as champion of the world. When you get to your seat, you put your extensions down, you pour yourself a glass of water, then you go over, shake your opponent's hand, and you know you're now going to play the final sessions of the World Championships. Even though it's a small venue, the Crucible Theatre, with the lights on the ceiling and the atmosphere and the long walk from your seat to the table, it makes it feel huge. No venue like it in the world.
Just great insight, Jimmy. I love the little things. I love the little things. And my favourite bit was this. That knock on the dressing room door. Wow.
Yeah, that's from the tournament director. I remember one year I was 14-8 up with Hendry and the wheels fell off. And then the next year he beat me 18-5. Mm. And that knock on the door was, you know, a terrible feeling because, you know you've lost. I was well behind and you just really want to get it over with because you can't win.
So Karen might not answer the knock. I mean, well,
he might not be in
that same situation. That's the honesty of it. He'll not throw the towel in. Of course, he's a warrior by name and by nature, but he knows.
Yeah, you know, you can see towards the last few frames of today, you know, he's not through the will of... Listen, he's a great player. He's going to be world champion. Mm. He's just got to improve a little bit on his cue ball and he's going to be a machine. But today you see a bit towards the end of the few frames that Ronnie won because Ronnie was all over him. You know, you sort of given up without trying to give up. You just can't. You just run out of steam.
Well, if he wants some inspiration, this man, as he walks into the Crucible for a last time with a smile on his face, Ronnie O'Sullivan won his first at the 9th time of asking. Here he goes to his seat. He will be magnanimous in defeat. If he wins, be the greatest night of snooker we've ever witnessed. Let's just say it as simple as that. Here comes the rocket.
The rocket, Ronnie O'Sullivan.
It feels like a coronation more than a game of snooker, but whatever happens and however quickly it happens, the pictures will be painted beautifully by Joe Johnson and Dave Hendon.
So another chapter is about to be written in the enduring story of Ronnie O'Sullivan. Just one frame required for a 6th world title. Karen Wilson needs the mother, the grandmother, the great-grandmother of all comebacks. All the damage done this afternoon.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, frame 26.
Karen Wilson to get the final session of the World Championship final underway, trailing 17-8. He won the first frame this afternoon and had a chance to win the second, but after losing that, it all went against him. His highest break for the rest of the afternoon was only 29. That tells its own story. O'Sullivan was here at 9 o'clock this morning practicing. He looked a bit flat, a bit tired maybe last night, but he's turned it around. And for him, just one more frame. And we've seen comebacks, Joe, over the years. It just seems impossible to see one this evening. You've got to win 10-0.
Yeah, it seems impossible. You wouldn't think that it was 17-8, the score, because the crowd was so emotional then when the players were coming in into the arena. And they'd have felt that elation that they felt early doors. Good kiss on the brow there from O'Sullivan. Yes, he'll give it everything. You know, he'll try his best, no doubt about that. He's still here, still playing.
Yes, and he's had a taste of the best occasion you can play in snooker, so I'm sure fill him with motivation to come back stronger.
a little short of pace on the cue ball there. He might just be tempted at this red to the right corner, O'Sullivan, with that big lead. Yeah, good shot.
One.
It's a pink ball. It does.
Well, 2001 was his first world title, 19 years ago now. Number one album in the UK was Destiny's Child, Survivor, which seems very apt, doesn't it? Because it was his destiny when he was young to be world champion. We all knew about Ronnie O'Sullivan when he was a boy. And he is a survivor. Everything that's happened on and off table over the last two decades, and he's still going strong at the top of the sport. But he's missed that black, so that's the first chance he's had to kill it off, and it's gone wrong.
Yes, he was just awkward on the red that he was close to. He was very close to it, slightly bridging over, and he had to play it at speed for the red to the middle. So, yep, good chance that.
Well, I know one thing, even though there'll be a lot of O'Sullivan supporters here, they'll want Karen Wilson to rally a little. They paid their money. He's lost the white in the, right in the middle of the pack.
Oh, that's a disaster. He caught the wrong red. That's why he's finished like that.
Just little clues. It might not be his night. Yeah, as I say, the audience, you know, they didn't even know, even a few days ago, that they could come tonight. They'll be hoping for as much snooker as Karen Wilson can summon up, but this is not a promising position.
Bramble.
Nominating Brown, so he shouldn't leave a red on, even if he misses it. Yeah, good shot.
Karen Wilson won.
But by hitting that side of the brown, he's left a long red on to the right corner. Had he caught the brown full, he wouldn't have been able to see this red. That's in the middle of the pocket. So another chance for O'Sullivan.
One.
Six world titles gets him level with Ray Reardon, who... he's a former coach of his. He helped him the second time he won the world title, 2004. And, of course, Steve Davis, his boyhood snooker idol. But it's the span, isn't it? It's the 19-year span, which is the really remarkable thing.
Yeah, for three decades, it's unbelievable, really, isn't it?
Well, the only other player who's done it in the World Championship over that length was Joe Davis, the first champion. 1927, he won his first title. 19 years later, he won his 15th and promptly retired. But the game is vastly different now to how it was then, clearly.
Seven.
Well, that's the score he's got to get to, 40. 61 points to be world champion.
Yes, and what a world championship 15. It would be to win, a tournament that may never have been on. It was, of course, postponed initially. A lot of work, and we must pay tribute to World Snooker Tour and their partners. A lot of work has gone into not only staging it, but staging it safely. They've accomplished that. And what a tournament. I remember the very first frame we did, Joe, on the first morning, it's a long time ago now, Tom Ford nearly had a maximum. That set the the tone for what's been a fascinating tournament, even though the final is one-sided. 21. The event itself has been superb.
Yeah, everybody I've spoke to has said what a great tournament it's been. Coverage has been fantastic. The players been superb. This man, he's got out of jail a few times, 20. Especially with Selby.
29.
It's just a shame about the final being so one-sided, but you know, that's because of O'Sullivan's ability.
The trophy waiting in the background.
36.
7 years since Ronnie O'Sullivan won the title.
37.
The other thing to say, of course, is he would go past Stephen Hendry's record of ranking 44. Titles. 37 to Hendry's 36.
45.
Well, he's two balls away.
Needed two chances, but it doesn't look like he's made any mistake on the second chance. No. Enjoy this man while you can.
Absolutely. The moment has come.
50.
It's a quick kill.
51.
Can he end with a century? That would end the championship on a real high note. If anyone could do it, it's this man. Karen Wilson, 58. Of course, had a bye in the first round, had that emotional semi-final against Anthony McGill. But it just started to go 59. Wrong for him this afternoon.
And wasn't it nice to see Karen Wilson clapping O'Sullivan on frame and match ball there? What a gentleman, what a sportsman.
66.
And what a shot.
67.
He's trying for the crowd.
There's never been anyone like him. Oldest champion since Ray Reardon, 1978, but the way he's playing, he could go 70. On and on and on.
71.
Check. Beautiful shot. Beautiful shot.
76.
So 81. These final four balls to end the championship with his 13th century. And get his hands on the check for £500,000, his biggest ever payday 85. From snooker. Showman.
Come on, come on. Little kiss. Little
96.
Kiss.
96 to finish. 96. The unique, the unconventional, the irrepressible, the brilliant. Ronnie O'Sullivan stands once again on top of the snooker world. This colossus of the Green Bays has conquered the Crucible for a sixth time. Well, it didn't last long, did it? That last frame, just 10 minutes. That was the evening session, just 10 minutes and 96. He's beaten Karen Wilson, 18-8. What a remarkable achievement. He struggled, of course, in recent years at the Crucible, but he's come good in 2020. Presentation will be a little bit different than usual.
Ladies and gentlemen,
here's Rob Walker, though, to take charge.
It has been, without doubt, the most poignant build-up to any world championship we've had here in the 44 years at the Crucible. And before we interview these two Herculean men, on behalf of everybody connected with this fantastic event, we wanted to extend our gratitude to a number of people. firstly, to tens of thousands of key workers up and down the country who will never meet. And thanks to them, all of us have got back to the job we love, to the sport we love, to the city we love. Equally, to all the familiar faces here at the Crucible, their staff and the World Snooker staff who've put an incredible amount of health and safety in place. You've never seen so many protocols backstage, so much hand sanitizer. Thanks to them, we have felt safe. And lastly, a thanks not only to these two, but to all 31 professional snooker players who turned up here in Sheffield on day one to bear their souls to the world and entertain us for 17 long days and remind us what a big part of our lives sport is and will continue to be for many years to come. And Kyron, I'd like nothing more than to give you a hug at the moment. I can't, for all the obvious reasons. This has been an absolutely incredible run to your maiden final. Only 30 men have ever played in the sport's ultimate match. That's how hard it is to get here. You should be so proud of what you've achieved over these 17 days.
Yeah, it's, I'm 28 years old. I'm not going to beat myself up too much. I'm playing the greatest of all time. For me, it was a dream come true knowing that I was going to be playing Ronnie in the final. Obviously, you know, you can't respect him too much or else he'll walk all over you, which is what's happened to me today. for me, look, it's brilliant. I've got the two most important people to me sat right here. They'll learn from this. It'll make them stronger as well.
Listen, you said you rolled over today, but you could have rolled over at 8-2 last night and you got yourself right back in the hunt late on. You showed some real character last night.
Yeah, I'm a fighter. I'll always be a fighter. I really struggled in the first session. I think we probably both had a little bit of a hangover from the semi-finals. And then I just thought, you know, I just relax, let the shackles off, go for it. And I was just annoyed that World Snooker wouldn't let me carry on and play the whole match last night, to be honest with you.
Well, you mentioned that semi-final. I've got to tell you, I'm not sure whether your brother Taylor told you this, but he came into the press room and spoke to us and said, at the beginning of that frame, he didn't know whether he was going to wet himself or be sick. And he walked 6 miles around the circumference of Sheffield. There were millions of people glued to their televisions. You somehow scraped yourself off the floor. That semi-final victory to book this maiden final was breathtaking and it will never, ever be forgotten. We're not quite sure how you came through that.
I'm not sure myself. Obviously, you know, it could well have been Anthony stood here right now. I was a bit lucky in the decider, but yeah, it was a phenomenal match, one that I'll remember for the rest of my life. And hopefully, obviously, me and Anthony have a few more battles here over the years. But look, at the end of the day, the night belongs to Ronnie. He was amazing throughout the final. Shown his class when he probably wasn't quite at his best and still stuck it out. So he was awesome this morning especially as well. I was very impressed.
Well, that shows incredible class that you are once again turning the spotlight on Ronnie. One other thing I'd like to ask you. People sometimes say there are no characters in snooker anymore. It's absolute rubbish. Yours has been an incredible journey. It's only a few years ago you were off the tour playing a little bit for fun, working in a bar. You've had these two fantastic young men added to your life. It's lit a fire underneath you, and here you are up at world number 6. This has been a great journey, and it continues to be so.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's lockdown's lit a fire on my head as well. The hair dye. Look, at the end of the day, I've got phenomenal family, friends, coach, sponsors, everything behind me. I'm a very lucky young man at 28 to have what I have and be playing the sport that I love, and it's given me an amazing life, and to perform in front of you guys has been an honour, and I'm glad that obviously the crowd were allowed in for the final. It's been amazing to perform in front of you guys.
Well, Kyron, spoken like a true champion. You have won three ranking titles, and hopefully there will be a Triple Crown triumph coming soon. I can't hand you the silver medal, but would you please step forward to collect your runner-up medal and your check, yeah, that one, and your check for £200,000. Kyron Wilson, ladies and gents. Can we hug? We've both been tested. Ladies and gents, we are in the presence of sporting greatness. History has been made tonight by Ronnie O'Sullivan. Absolutely incredible. Your sixth world title, and now you are tied with Reardon and Davis. Amazing.
Yeah, no, I never really think about titles because when I was a kid, I never dreamed I'd be here. I just was playing for the fun of the game, and I still try and play for the fun of it. But to be here and, you know, I've had all them victories, and, you know, it's a dream, but it's kind of becoming a bit of a reality as well. So it's nice to be living your dream in that sort of way, you know.
Your last title was 2013. Was there a spell during those years where you thought you might never get your hands on the Silver Lady again?
You never say never, but there was a part of me that decided that, you know, I probably didn't play enough, and I still probably don't play enough to justify winning, you know, a tournament of this stature, you know, because it's an endurance test, and if I'm not really an endurance type snooker player because I don't compete enough. But, you know, the lockdown gave me a chance to play on some decent, you know, because I haven't even got a practice facility, believe it or not. So my friend installed a couple of tables in his office in London. So I was able to play on good tables for a change, which was great. And I come here feeling comfortable with my tools, really. So I had a half a chance. I never expected to win it, though, to be honest with you.
Spoken with real modesty for a guy that's lifted it five times and now six. Ronnie, there have been so many great achievements down the years. Your first Triple Crown triumph at the age of 17 in 1993, winning this one after a year off, 1,000 centuries. Your 19th Triple Crown title when you won the UK in 2018. Where does this sit in the all-time performances of your career? It's got to be right there near the top, surely.
Listen, any world title you win's got to be up there. You know, it's great to be able to win over the 17 days here. You know, you come here, you've got to play a lot of solid shots and be solid in all departments. And, you know, even though I might not have felt I'd done that, I must have done, because these guys are too good on tour to give it to you, you know. And I just want to say, you know, as well for Kyron, you know, he's a top player, you know, he's improving all the time, and all that, you know, he fell off the tour. He was always going to get back on the tour. When you've got that desire and that hunger and that belief in your ability, you might have to work in a bar for a bit, you might have to do bits and pieces, but deep down that fire is burning bright enough so you actually get there in the end. And, you know, so he's a winner and he will win this tournament one day. Not to put too much pressure on him, but he is a country mile above everybody else around his age. And and he'll be the first to admit that he's always watching the Higginses, the Williamses and the likes of them players, because he wants to raise that bar as well. So when someone's that student about their sport, you know that they're going to have plenty of good days as well. So his time's definitely going to come.
Beautifully said. All the pundits down in our studio in London are saying you are now unequivocally the greatest. 37 ranking titles. No one's more won more Triple Crowns. Tying Hendry on seven, is it even a relevance? Are you happy to be with Steve on six?
I'm happy to be on a cut on one. I was happy to get one at one stage. You know, two was great. And once I hit four, I went, you know, I can call myself like one of the greats, you know, because all the greats seem to have done it. I look at John Higgins and go, he's a great, you know. So if he's won it four times, that's what you've got to do to be a great. Probably put Mark Williams in there, just the bat.
Well, he's won three.
But I'll put it at four. So anything above four, you've got, you know, you kind of, you're in that sort of fantastic company, I suppose. But I think, you know, the way I look at it is, though, like, it's with the records with Hendry, it's like, if I've played more tournaments than him to get there, I think who got there first? I'm not sure, so you'll have to ask someone of the stats. But I'm always, if I've played 1,000 tournaments and he's only made 500 and I'm just about beating his records, then I'd rather have Stephen's CV, do you know what I mean? So you'll have to get your statistic book out for that. But I suppose my thing has been longevity. You know, I go in and out of form, you know, my mind can wander sometimes, but then I just get a little bit of a taste for it and think, come on, let's see if you still got it. And start to, you know, try and have a go again, like I have done this tournament, you know.
And just finally, a word for your fans. They have followed you for decades. This is a very difficult time for so many people. Yeah. Once again, they have turned out in great numbers. This has been a journey, not just for you, but for everybody who supported you. And it must give you great pride that you've given people something to focus on other than the virus over the last 17 days.
Yeah, well, listen, I want to thank my sponsors as well, Affinity. They've been fantastic, you know. Without their support, without 19.com support, you know, I wouldn't be able to put the hours in and sacrifice some of the things I have to sacrifice, because like Kyron says, we all need support, you know. We play snooker, but it's nice to have people around you that are able to support you through that, so as you can make it such a comfortable ride. And hopefully Affinity are going to try and create a wonderful app where they can sort me out the perfect cue action, because they're good at doing that stuff. So I've given them a task. I said, come on, create it, so as I can, like, you know, get the perfect cue action, because, you know, as snooker players, that's all we want to do. That's all. Listen, when you put in 5 or 6 hours in a day, it's not because you like the sound of the balls hitting the back of the pocket. It's like, can I be hitting it straight enough so as when I come and play under pressure, it stands up? And that's why we put all the hours in, not because, you know, we'd rather be sitting there watching Match of the Day, to be honest, or watching you off hanging off of some boat interviewing someone while he's doing the rowing. Yeah.
Well, that was a long time ago, as was your first major triumph. 27 years of longevity, ladies and gentlemen. There is only one Ronnie O'Sullivan. And Ronnie, there is an old silver lady who's been waiting for a kiss for 7 years. Would you please raise the trophy? You are the 2020 Betfred World Snooker Champion.
Well, it was short and sweet in the end, but it's still a fairy tale ending. The fact this tournament was on at all credit goes to the organisers. And look at that for a picture. The greatest snooker player of all time. You know, when we're all old and grey and looking back on our lives, we can say we were there to see him do it. As Joe said, treasure him while you can, and I'm sure he will be back next year to try and level up Stephen Hendry's magnificent seven. But the night belongs to Ronnie O'Sullivan. Congratulations to him.
But at some stage, we have to all simply give up predicting the career of Ronnie O'Sullivan. It's kind of like the world's greatest roller coaster. You're just better to strap yourself in, try to hang on, and try not to wet yourself. Lightning in a crack bottle, flawed genius, natural-born snooker legend, take your pick. He's just Ronnie O'Sullivan, Jimmy White.
Yeah, he's just, you know, he's just a class act. You know, 27 years since he won his first world title. That's incredible. And he's gone in front now of Stephen Hendry at the most ranking tournaments ever. So he will now be back to try and equal Hendry's record and try and get one better. And then you probably might only play in a few tournaments, but he will be definitely after them records for sure.
Yeah. And Jimmy, you know her very well. There's his fiance. I mean, it's hard enough watching him. Imagine trying to live with him.
Yeah, she's pretty calm, actually. She sort of just lets him get on with his game and, you know, he goes and practices and does his stuff. But it's great to see him happy. And, you know, all the snooker players really like him as well. He is a top fella.
It's been so nice to be able to have some fans in at a safe distance. It's been so well marshalled here. And although he can't go up and have pictures taken and sign autographs, he can get close enough as he starts to walk around that table. And it was a case of him clicking at some stage in the final. He did it this afternoon, and the rest is actually history.
Yeah, as soon as he found his game, as soon as he got his scoring boots on, got control of that cue ball, there was only one winner for me, and that's what Ronnie does to a lot of players. Mark Selby will be kicking himself a little bit because he had him in all sorts of trouble. Mark Williams had him in all sorts of trouble, 6-2 up. He managed to survive them matches. And as you say, the rest is history.
I've talked about this so many times. I leave the snooker to Jimmy and Folsey and Joe and our brilliant team that we have who played the game. But when it comes to the 6 inches between the head, that's kind of where the journalists have to step in a little bit. Last year, it was so obvious Judd Trump's head was in the right place. No guarantees you're ever going to win this, but he was absolutely where he needed to be. We talked to Ronnie before he played a single shot, Jimmy, and we looked at each other and we said, mind in the perfect place.
Absolutely, and he's won these tournaments before when he's been running and he's like fit and he's like gone through these tournaments like a knife through butter. You told me that you'd done an interview with him just before lockdown,
yep,
and you said that's the best you've ever seen him. Folsey tipped him up a few months ago. I tipped him up because I just think he's been so long since he's won the World Championship, 7 years, he's too good not to. And he just come along and just play flawless snooker at times. And when you can do that, all your opponent can do is just admire his brilliance.
Yeah, over the years, the things that we used to say were unpredictable became predictable. We predict the weather pretty well now. We've got all these satellites in the sky, all this imaging. But I don't think there's any type of technology that we could invent that could predict Ronnie O'Sullivan. And what he does next is anybody's guess.
Absolutely, but, you know, he was all at sea against Carl Wilson. He was bending his elbow in, the cue was here, and then all of a sudden, all his disciplines come back, and, you know, he's walking into the shot, and then all of a sudden he's back online, and then that's when he can just click into gear. And I think he won 6 frames on the trot today.
Seven. If you include the one tonight, it's 8 over the 2 sessions to win it. Of course, there's obviously going to be times when in Ronnie's interviews you just say, OK, we'll just park that, let's not try and work it out. But actually, a lot of times during this tournament when people were saying, well, what's he talking about? He was actually speaking the gospel. He was saying, my cue action isn't right. But because by his standards, you're like, how can that be when you're beating Ding and coming back against Mark Williams and you're winning with over 270 unanswered points against Mark Selby, but it was bang right by his standards. It was all over the shop at times.
Yeah, sometimes you know, you have to take some things he says with a pinch of salt, you know, where snooker's concerned. But he actually said that about his cue action 2 or 3 times during this tournament. And then all of a sudden it clicked. And, you know, when it clicked, he's such a prolific scorer and really does know how to win, and his safety play puts you in so much trouble. He can be more or less impossible to beat sometimes.
It's very easy to be revisionist. It's very easy to use hindsight, and I don't want to try and do that. The one thing, though, that was prevalent on day two, and I think made a very big difference, was not having fans actually, for Ronnie, was a little easier, I think, because the goldfish bottle can be what makes him sometimes react and want to get away and be on a barge or be running through a forest, where actually he was able to get... He was sitting having coffee over there half an hour before Ding, and I think one person said hello.
Yeah, no, he is good with his fans. He loves the fans, and we do exhibitions all over the world, and, you know, obviously these selfies and things like that probably won't be happening in the future, but, you know, it was easy for him to get in and out of the venue, so that's why he put a bit more practice in. You know, and he was practicing this morning. He didn't practice yesterday morning, and he didn't play very well. This morning I see him in here at 10:30, and he was practicing on the table, tuning up for this match today. And, God, boy, did he play well today.
Yeah. Well, let's just have a look at how he won it. We wondered how long it would be. It was just a few seconds over 6 minutes. And here we go, Jimmy.
Yeah, this was a great long red. You know, he pops the long red there, gets perfect on the blue, and goes on to make a century break. Here's the trophy. So, you know, and it's nice to win the World Championships with a century break, and he got £25,000 for the charity for that.
I think he just missed the black in that, but yeah, maybe we can all chip in at one stage. But this was, to be fair, it was sort of an easier execution in a way for Karen. He knew he was beaten, and not a bad thing that happened this way.
Yeah, Karen would be pleased it was all over. He doesn't want to be out there when it's that far behind. He knows he can't win, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, listen, let's just stay with this for a little bit as Ronnie comes into the room right now. There he is having a chat with Kieran. And right now, he's just having some private moments with his family, so we're not going to break that up just yet, Jimmy. And it doesn't matter who the player is, how big a star it is, you can hear the kerfuffle there. It is about those people that you're with. Jimmy, it is about those people that know and love you and you share the moment with them.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he's with his dad's arrived and his girlfriend's there, you know, and his friend Robbie, who's been with him for 17 days. So it's an amazing moment for everybody who's involved.
OK, well, listen, Jimmy, I'll ask you to step out. Please welcome on to Eurosport, definitely looking a pay rise off Eurosport, the 2020 World Snooker Champion, Ronnie O'Sullivan. Congratulations to you.
How you doing, mate? You all right?
I did tell you, I don't know what all the fuss has been.
Yeah, you tipped me, didn't you? You know your stuff, you know your sport, you must watch a bit.
I was saying, right, everything you said was the absolute truth. Your cue action was going in and out.
Yeah.
You were really struggling to get it. You weren't lying, you weren't being obtuse.
No.
And we saw it more and more as the tournament went on. It was blatantly obvious it was clicking in and out. What was the tech? I'm going to ask you about snooker, massive departure here.
Yeah.
What changed to get those seven frames in a row? Did something click? Did you change something?
Yeah, well, I normally go for a run in the morning, but I just thought, right, this morning I had to go on a practice table for an hour. After last night, I was completely, like, unable to put balls together. You know, I couldn't hit any solid shots. Kyron was really, you know, striking it well, scoring well. And for me to get four frames, it was only because he potted the blue and potted the red, fouled, unlucky, and the other frame he missed the red. Otherwise, I lose them two frames as well, and I should have really been behind. So I thought, I've got out of jail 10-7. I've now owe it to myself to get on the practice table and try and find a slot or a swing technique or a swing fault to go into this afternoon session with. And I messed around with my grip, and I found something which I could hold the cue a little bit online, I could hold my finish a bit better, and it just gave me a bit of confidence to go out there and be able to compete, you know, because all you want to do is compete, you know, and it would have been horrible for me to not have made a game of it, you know, because, you know, that's what people want to see, you know.
You've had those moments six times now where you hit that one shot that you know wins you a world title. The first time you did it way back against Higgins, the two times you did it against Carter, and so on and so on. Does it still feel the same? What goes on inside your body when you go, oh, it's mine again?
It's weird because I think, like, mentally, you train yourself to stay in the moment so much, you know, never to get too far in your head because, you know, the minute you start thinking about making speeches and what am I going to say to this one and that one, I've missed game ball and thought, what have I done, you know? So, you know, I've worked with Steve Peters and, you know, we had a... 3 months ago, I said, look, I really want to give it a good go, and I haven't really worked that closely with you, Steve, although we're friends, and he's like a father figure, such a lovely human being, and we've always been friends, but I said, like, let's really connect. So we were doing a lot of Zoom and FaceTime because of the lockdown, and, you know, I had a few mental thoughts that I could carry with me, so every time I felt like it was getting a bit out of shape, I kind of just went back to what we were working on, and it just kept me present. And I just, like, some of them sessions where I weren't too good and I wasn't in the groove and I wasn't finding that slot and I wasn't penetrating the ball as well, I was able to not sabotage, basically, and just stay in the match and recover from the next session.
And it's exactly what you've told me standing here as a pundit.
Yeah.
Two things. Respect the game because it'll catch you otherwise. And the other thing you've always said, it's played between the ears, the 6 inches between the ears. And if you're not happy off the table, Ronnie, it's not, especially with your 100-mile-an-hour brain, it's not going to be happy on the table.
Yeah.
It's going to be torrid. Yeah. It's going to be like a jail rather than a profession.
Yeah.
So that all ties in perfect because the last 7 months have been a really calm period for you in the head.
Yeah. Like I said, you know, it's very important to get that balance right, to feel competitive, because you don't want to be too relaxed. Sometimes you need that little bit of fire in your belly, and it's okay to kind of show that emotion sometimes, but then you have to kind of box it, put it away and go, right, we're here to focus on the job and do what we've got to do. So, yeah, you know, I've just tried to, you know, like I said, even before, like, every match that I've come to play when I'm wearing my suit, I've not gone on a practice table. I've got my phone out, I've put my Sky app on, I've watched a bit of Honey Falls and all, so there's a bit of Storage Wars, and just enjoyed that, because that's the worst bit, you know, when you're waiting to play. So I thought, if I can make that part as enjoyable as possible, don't need to practice. You've done years and years of it. My build-up was good coming here. So, you know, I found ways to kind of get through the moments where the mind can wander, because I've got a very overactive brain.
Absolutely.
You're right.
He dares wins. That's what they say. do you know when your pictures pop up on your phone from years ago and it's a bit embarrassing?
Yeah.
Well, this is it in overdrive, right? They're great moments for you, but when you put them all together, I'm probably going to have to get you to explain some of the haircuts. So this is after nine times of asking, by the way. This is against John Higgins, 2014. Yeah. Well, talk me through that haircut.
Oh, that's a blinder, that one, isn't it? I don't know where that one come from. I must have been in some lockdown for that to go that long.
Two on the bounce here against Alan Carter, of course, 2008, and then the first of your back-to-back.
Yeah, 2012. That was never meant to happen, really. I never expected to get another... Mm-hmm. I was just my game was all over the gaff. And then the following year... Yeah, but I put it down to Steve Peters, really, you know, because I probably wouldn't have, you know... I don't know, I think for me, the big change has been the mental side of it.
Yeah.
I haven't always applied myself and played all the tournaments and whatever, but I've always stuck on to... You know, trying to work that side of it. And if I have gone to tournaments, I'm always prepared, but just probably didn't play enough to be as good as some of the other guys have been, you know, winning the tournaments.
I think we have to go back to Ray Reardon for an older winner in the 70s. Would have been his last one, obviously, because you get older. And we see you there, the Silver Fox, as we might have to start calling you soon. But this is different, isn't it, because you're fit?
Yeah, I feel very fit at the moment. I've done 17 weeks of running, the first time in 10 years. I'm able to go out and do any, you know, I can do anything up to 10 miles, been doing like 40 miles a week. So I'm in a half-decent shape, and I hope to get in even better shape, you know, because the running has been fantastic for the mental health. I can eat a little bit more and not worry about piling on the pounds. It's just, like my friend said, he's your midfielder, you know, when he's on the pitch... And you're running, everything else seems to kind of fall into place. And I think that's key for me. You know?
Does having this, being back up, I think I put you number two in the world as far as I was looking earlier. I'm not great at huge amounts of money. I've never had them. Does having this, being the proud owner of the most famous trophy again in snooker, bought by Joe Davis, whose book has been inspiring you.
Yeah, of course.
Does this change anything for the next year, or will we see you pick and choose your tournaments and get that life balance?
No, yeah, I don't know if this means I don't have to qualify for the overseas events. So if I don't have to qualify for the overseas events, then I'll probably play more overseas events because, you know, like the big tournaments are in China and I love going to Germany and Austria, but I just don't want to have to go to Barnsley to have to get through the qualifiers. So, you know, I haven't been number one, I haven't been world champion, so I haven't played in them tournaments for a while. So I think the key is to try and play there and play more in China because it's come towards the end of my career and I just think that's a great place to sort of, you know, apply your trade, really, you know, because, you know, I just enjoy my time out there well. So, you know, I won't be playing any more, you know, if I want that home balance and, you know, I play snooker because I choose to, not because I have to now. So it's important that I just play it when I feel like it, really.
Your first ever final was against John Higgins, right? We're talking about, as you said earlier, win four, you're a great.
Yeah.
If there was one final you could pick now, if you were to be able to compete to this to win a seventh equal Stephen Hendry, would you like it to be against Mark Williams? Would you like it to be against John Higgins? Would you like it to be against someone who's breathing that air?
Listen, there's so many players. I mean, I love playing Williams because we grew up as a kid playing each other and we know each other. He knows me better than I know myself, and I know him better than he knows himself. So when we play each other, it's like a poker player. You can spot if they're bluffing or not, you know. So Higgins, another great player. Probably wouldn't want to play John because if he's on, he's just too good. You know what I mean? So I'd probably go for someone like, you know, Selby would be good. I mean, because he's a real heavyweight player. He's got the pedigree. And, you know, you beat someone like Selby, you know you've won. You know, you've got to win them matches. So, listen, why not? Why not bring Joe Davis back? Let me have a go at Joe.
Oh, no, don't go on about Joe again. We get into it saying. But I think the way for you to win a seventh of this, and obviously feel free to disagree, is for you, for it not to be your focus. I think that's how we see Ronnie lift the seven. The Ronnie that goes back to playing everywhere probably isn't going to lift that because by the time you get here, Shredsville. You know?
Do you know what? I've realised I really struggle with the mayhem and the crowds being at this tournament. I just thought it was just the pressure of the World Championships. It wasn't to do anything to do with that because up until the final, I was playing at home. Although we was playing the Crucible, I didn't have to put up with all... Not put up with it, but it just affected me, you know, and I just couldn't relax because I was just felt like I was just being... I couldn't just... Yeah. I had to lock myself away, basically.
I can if you don't mind that, because I don't want it to come across in a different way, because I can understand it. You're very introverted away from the thing. Your solace and your peace and quiet is needed for your mental health. Yeah. And I don't like it when people pick up on it in another way. Mm. We talk about mental health a little bit more now, but not as much. You find your peace in quiet.
Yeah.
So any period of 2 weeks, whether it be family staying, whether it be a tournament, messes with the head.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, you're right. But I noticed a difference when they let a crowd in and there's people at stage door and like people in the crowd. And although I get a lot of support, believe me, I'm better off without the crowd, to be honest with you, because it's too much pressure. I feel the weight of them wanting me to do well. And up until the final, I just felt, I felt a bit of pressure, nice nerves, but not to the point where it just... And then for the final, I don't know, like, we both had our supporters, but I preferred it when it was empty, to be honest with you. But that's just me. I just don't deal with feeling that I have to deliver and perform. You know, it's hard. It's hard to do that, you know?
You've thought about sabotaging next year. You could use the money you've won to buy all the tickets.
No, listen, it's like what Layla came down yesterday and we were hanging out, having breakfast now, and she went, right, today, I'm not seeing you. Get on what you got to do. Da-da-da-da. And she knows that you need to be in that mindset. Yeah. So it's good that she was able to, you know, and she was right. And today I just got up, done my practice, done what I had to do. And, you know, she like Mark Williams, she knows me better than I know myself. Do you know what I mean? So sometimes I need to be told, do you know what I mean? Because I do everything wrong. Yeah. I even phoned Steve Peters out. I said, Steve, I've got like 140 messages. I've only got 10 tickets. I feel really bad. What should I do? He went, don't answer none of them. Just focus on your snooker and your real friends will understand. And, you know, you can catch up with them afterwards. But me, I just want to like... make sure everyone's all right. And, you know, you've got to focus on the job in hand sometimes.
Final question. And the fact he works for us is brilliant. When would you ever keep somebody who's just won the World Championship for this long? But he gets paid for this as well. It's crazy. What's your proudest moment of the 2 weeks and a few days? What is the moment where you go, that's the bit I'll pull out? And I won't allow you to have the win, you know, like...
Yeah, I'll take that out.
But what's the moment you go, wow, I'm so pleased about
it? I think the point against when I was 16-14 down against Selby, and I hung on. And when I got back to 13-all, my thought was, I'm just pleased I've made a bit of a match of it and I've made the scoreboard respectable. And I thought, 13-all, if I get beat 17-13, it ain't great, but no one can say I took a drub in. Selby's like one of the best match player, if you like. And to produce three frames like I did at that time, that snooker god stuff, you know, that was just, you know... But again, you know, I was present, I was doing all I could, I left everything out there, and I think that was just someone saying, look, there's your chance, there's a bit of form. You know, and I was there to take the advantage. So I think that was probably the biggest highlight of this tournament, if you like.
Yeah. Well, listen, I'm sure I can get a clap from the room for the first time ever. There's people in. Ladies and gentlemen, 2020 World Snooker Champion. Take the trophy with you, Ronnie. Ronnie O'Sullivan. Take the trophy with you, my friend.
Oh, so I take it with you. Yeah.
Well done. And Jimmy White will come in near, and the frames that he was referring to there is absolutely what you would want to choose. Frame 30, 31, 32 and 33 of that match against Mark Selby are probably the four frames, Jimmy, those last four against Selby, that sum up that man more than any other. The 30 of smashing the balls, I'm not going to get into safeties, I'll do this, this is my unorthodox way, this is where I'm going to play, to then over 270 unanswered points.
Yeah, it was amazing when he was, you know, he was well behind in that game. And, you know, there was, I think he was 13-9 down as well. You know, and then from 16-14, he played two brilliant frames. And it wasn't on, he created them chances and made two winning breaks. And in the last frame, had a 60-odd. Selby pulled it back to the last thread, but Ronnie managed to get the last thread. And then gone on and won the World Championships.
Yeah, Jimmy, it's been an absolute pleasure to spend 17, 18 days in a box with you. Nobody can make it as enjoyable as this man. And so we never have a crossword, do we?
We have good fun, actually.
Yeah, we never have a crossword. And I think, just like we said 16 months ago, the right man won.
Yeah, make no mistake, he's the best player on the planet.
Absolutely. Legend. Right, there you go. That was the World Snooker Championship on Eurosport. Thank you so much for tuning in. But as you know, we're not part-time when it comes to snooker. We will be here throughout the whole season, whether it, where it starts, when it starts. Have a little look at that. The World Grand Prix is not in the UK, but everywhere else across Europe. And here in the UK, you'll get all of those tournaments when the World Snooker Tour kicks off again. We are committed full-time to it with our team of Joe Johnson, Neil Foulds, Dave Hendon, Philip Studd, Jimmy White, and, of course, Ronnie O'Sullivan. And that's it. The Rocket is the world champion for a sixth time. There is nothing you can really say to sum them up apart from there has never been a player cut from the same cloth. In fact, I'm just thinking, I've just realised, the current world champion is a full-time Eurosport pundit. This time next April, Jimmy White. Good night.
I ain't finished.